You're listening to the audio production of Jesus Calling for Graduates by Sarah Young, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Bill Russell and Nan Gurley. Introduction by Sarah Young.
A note to grads. Dear graduate, congratulations on your accomplishment. I hope you are able to savor this moment in your life, this moment in time that is full of celebration and anticipation of new beginnings. You might be moving away for the first time, going to college, starting a new job, or perhaps doing all three. Whatever journey you find yourself about to embark on, I would like to share some truths I have carried with me on my own journeys. No matter what season of life we find ourselves in, we can rest in the knowledge that Jesus is our constant. When changes swirl around us, we can trust that He is the light that shows us the way and the love that never lets us go. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8 reminds us that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What a wonderful encouragement to know that our Savior never changes. I have found the more connected I am to Jesus, the more peaceful and content I can be. As you are meeting new people, rising to new challenges, and making many decisions on your own, you need more than ever to connect to Him. I hope that this book will remind you whom to seek when you need guidance, whom to cling to when you need hope, and whose presence is with you continually. Stay faithful in prayer and grounded in biblical truth. May the Lord bless you and keep you close to Him as you set out on the adventure before you. Beautiful blessings, Sarah Young.
Introduction. I first experienced the presence of God in a setting of exquisite beauty. I was living and studying at a Christian community in a tiny alpine village in France. This was a branch of L'Aubrie, an international ministry that began in Switzerland through Francis and Edith Schaeffer's work. During my stay at L'Aubrie, I was free to explore the fairyland-like environment all around me. It was late winter, and the noonday sun was warm enough for sunbathing, but the depth of the snow kept it from melting. Brilliant sunlight reflecting from pure white snow was cleansing my mind of the darkness that had held it captive for years. Every day I climbed up a steep hill to attain a view that delighted my soul. As I stood at the top, I would lose myself in a panorama of unbroken beauty. Below me was the village that had become my home. Viewed from this height, the village was dominated by a high steepled church. Turning 180 degrees, I could see Lake Geneva far below me, shouting greetings in refracted sunbeams. When I looked up, I saw icy tips of alpine mountains encircling me. I would turn round and round, absorbing as much as I could with two eyes and a finite mind. The daughter of a college professor, I had been encouraged to read widely and think for myself. I had majored in philosophy at Wellesley College and had almost completed my master's degree at Tufts University. A few months earlier, my brother had asked me to read Schaeffer's Escape from Reason. To my great surprise and delight, that small book had answered questions I'd long before dismissed as unanswerable. It was the intellectual integrity of Francis Schaeffer's teaching that had drawn me to that pristine place. Though the quest that had taken me there was a search for truth, it was God's glorious creation that helped me open my heart to Him. One night I found myself leaving the warmth of our cozy chalet to walk alone in the snowy mountains. I went into a deeply wooded area feeling vulnerable and awed by the cold, moonlit beauty. The air was crisp and dry, piercing to inhale. Suddenly, I felt as if a warm mist enveloped me. I became aware of a lovely presence, and my involuntary response was to whisper, "Sweet Jesus." This utterance was totally uncharacteristic of me, and I was shocked to hear myself speaking so tenderly to Jesus. As I pondered this brief communication, I realized it was the response of a converted heart. At that moment, I knew I belonged to Him. This was far more than the intellectual answers for which I'd been searching. This was a relationship with the creator of the universe. The following year, back in the United States, I had another encounter with the presence of Jesus. I was grieving the loss of a serious dating relationship and wondering whether being a Christian made much difference in the quality of my life. At that time, I was working as a technical writer in Virginia. My boss sent me to Atlanta to attend a conference. I accepted this assignment dutifully and checked into the hotel without enthusiasm. Alone in my room, I felt waves of desolation wash over me. So I began walking the streets of Atlanta aimlessly, trying to escape my solitude. I glanced at some books in an outdoor stall and was drawn to Beyond Ourselves by Catherine Marshall. That night, as I read the book, I no longer felt alone. I knelt beside the bed in that sterile room and felt an overwhelming presence of peace and love come over me. I knew Jesus was with me and that he sympathized with my heartache. This was unquestionably the same sweet Jesus I had met in the Alps. During the next 16 years, I lived what many people might consider an exemplary Christian life. I went to Covenant Theological Seminary in St. Louis, where I earned a master's degree in counseling and biblical studies. While there, I met my husband, Steve, a third-generation missionary to Japan. After graduation, we spent 2 4-year terms in Japan doing church planting work. We had a baby girl during our first term and a baby boy during our furlough in the United States. After our second term, we returned to the U.S. for 3 years. We lived in Atlanta, where Steve worked with a local Japanese church, and I earned a further degree in counseling at Georgia State University. As part of my training, I worked at a Christian counseling center in the Atlanta area. I cherished my experiences of helping deeply wounded women find healing in Christ. I was also thankful for my kind, loving husband and our 2 delightful children who were the main joys of my life. However, not once during those 16 years did I vividly experience the presence of Jesus. So, in the summer of 1990, I began a new quest. It started with delving into a devotional book, The Secret of the Abiding Presence, by Andrew Murray. The theme of this book is that God's presence is meant to be Christians' continual experience. Murray emphasizes the importance of spending time alone with God in quiet, uninterrupted communion. I began reading the book at a very unstructured time in my life. We were waiting for our Australian visas to be approved so that we could begin a church among Japanese people living in Melbourne. I had quit my job to prepare for the move overseas, so I was adjusting to the loss of my fulfilling work as a counselor. In the midst of those momentous changes, I began seeking God's presence in earnest. My days started alone with God, equipped with Bible, devotional book, prayer journal, pen, and coffee. As I waited in His presence, God began to reveal Himself to me. An hour or two alone with Him seemed too brief. The uncertainties I faced at that time deepened my increasing closeness to God. My husband and I had no idea how long it would take to receive permanent residency visas, so the waiting period seemed to stretch indefinitely into the future. During that period, I had 4 surgeries, including 2 for melanoma. A Bible verse that comforted me during this difficult time of waiting also accompanied me on the seemingly endless flight to Australia. "You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace." Isaiah 55:12. We settled in Australia and began our dual ministries. I supported Steve in planting the first ever Japanese church in Melbourne, but my main ministry focus was counseling Australian women, some of whom were coming out of terrible abuse and spiritual bondage. Our combined ministries subjected our family to intense spiritual warfare, and I prayed for protection every morning. One morning as I prayed, I visualized God protecting each of us. I pictured first our daughter, then our son, and then Steve encircled by God's protective presence, which looked like golden light. When I prayed for myself, I was suddenly enveloped in brilliant light and profound peace. I lost all sense of time as I experienced God's presence in this powerful way. I had not sought the experience, but I received it gratefully and was strengthened by it. Only 2 or 3 days later, a counseling client, who was an incest survivor, began remembering experiences of satanic ritual abuse. This form of Satan worship involves subjecting victims, who are often young children, to incredibly evil, degrading tortures. My courageous client and I walked together into the darkness of her memories. But God had prepared me for stepping into deep darkness by first bathing me in His glorious light. I realized that experiences of God's presence were not only for my benefit, but were also preparation for helping others. During that same year, 1992, I began reading God Calling, a devotional book written by 2 anonymous listeners. These women practiced waiting quietly in God's presence, pencils and paper in hand, recording the messages they received from Him. The messages are written in first person, with I designating God. While I was living in Japan, someone had mailed this book to me from the U.S. I had not read it at that time, but I had held on to the book through 2 international moves. 6 or 7 years later, this little paperback became a treasure to me. It dovetailed remarkably well with my longing to live in Jesus' presence. The following year, I began to wonder if I, too, could receive messages during my times of communing with God. I had been writing in prayer journals for years, but that was one-way communication. I did all the talking. I knew that God communicated with me through the Bible, but I yearned for more. Increasingly, I wanted to hear what God had to say to me personally on a given day. I decided to listen to God with pen in hand, writing down whatever I believed He was saying. I felt awkward the first time I tried this, but I received a message. It was short, biblical, and appropriate. It addressed topics that were current in my life: trust, fear, and closeness to God. I responded by writing in my prayer journal. My journaling had changed from monologue to dialogue. Soon, messages began to flow more freely, and I bought a special notebook to record these words. This new way of communicating with God became the high point of my day. I knew these writings were not inspired as Scripture is, but they were helping me grow closer to God. I have continued to receive personal messages from God as I meditate on Him. The more difficult my life circumstances, the more I need these encouraging directives from my Creator. Sitting quietly in God's presence is just as important as the writings I glean from these meditative times. In fact, some days I simply sit with Him for a while and write nothing. During these times of focusing on God, I may experience fullness of joy in His presence, Psalm 16:11, or I may simply enjoy His gentle company and receive His peace. During the years that I have been listening to God with pen in hand, I have found themes of His peace becoming more prominent in my writing. I'm sure this tendency reflects, in part, my personal need. However, when I get to know people, I find that most of them also desire the balm of Jesus' peace. A life-changing verse has been, "Be still and know that I am God." Psalm 46:10. alternate readings for be still are relax, let go, and cease striving.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.